please welcome him now.
Mr. Prime Minister, Baruch Haba.
Thank you for having me. Baruchim Hanimtzaim.
I just would like to begin our conversation by observing that I have conducted many conversations with touring authors, but this is the first time that I've had a conversation with someone who has not merely written about history, but is history. And it's a great honor to be with you. My first question is based on a passage from your book. You write in your book that Defense Minister Avigdor Lieberman and Education Minister Naftali Bennett are, in your words, committed to establishing a greater Israel with permanent Israeli control over all the West Bank territory we've held since the Six-Day War a half century ago. And you go on to say, my overriding concern is what this would mean for Israel. This greater Israel will be unquestionably larger in terms of territory, yet it shows signs of being smaller in other ways, less cohesive, less Jewish, less open and democratic, and more isolated than the state whose embattled beginnings I witnessed as a child 70 years ago. I think many of us in the room tonight share those concerns. And I picked that passage to begin with because you make a reference to the Jews of the Galut. And my question to you is this: what is the proper role for American Jews who share your concerns about politics and government in Israel?
I think that as long as Israel always aspires to be not just the place for Israelis who are living there, but the government always used to say that we are the government of the whole Jewish people. And you all have the right of coming into Israel, becoming immediately citizens, and even get some support from the government. We are taking ourselves as responsible for the fate of the Jewish people, not just for those who are coming into Israel. And I think that this partnership has two sides. It's not about charity, it's not about patronizing each other, it's about a mature relationship between adults, between equal and adult communities, mature communities. And I think that what happens right now, especially in regard to Jewish identity, is in a way a shame. What happens along the Kotel is a shame. I don't see anyone on earth who can dictate to a Jewish person what it means to be a Jew. I always like the answer that Golda Meir used to give when at the height of the debate in Israel, who is a Jew? Her answer was, whoever wants to be one deserves it. And I think, you know, whenever we spend some time Friday evening at the table of a Reform family here in the United States, I always tell my wife, Nili, that they are more Jewish than I am. They at least know the text and know the difference between Abdallah and the Moitzi and whatever. I was never in a synagogue, I was brought up in a kibbutz, never had a normal bar mitzvah or anything else, and I don't feel less Jewish than the chief rabbi or than the leader of Litvak yeshiva. Somewhere I'm of Litvak origins, and my father was the cheder of Reb Shach in Ponivezh, out of all places, but I never felt less Jewish than anyone. And I think of you, we are partners. So, first of all, I would expect American Jewry to raise its voice about issues that have to do with Israel. Israeli government usually expect all of you to repeat or keep repeating whatever comes from Jerusalem as if it came from heaven. It didn't. It came from the freely elected, legitimate government of Israel, which happened to be my government as well. But I find myself criticizing something very harshly, many of the policies of this government. So I think that part of a partnership is the readiness to criticize, to raise your voice, to make clear what you think about what happens in Israel. I think it will help Israel and it will strengthen you here. It will somehow help Israel to be more open to the need, not just to be strong physically, militarily, but to always hold to the moral high ground, which help our unity and will help you to convince your own young generation that Israel is still is on the right track. And bearing this in mind, I think that that's the recommendation I can make. I think that the behavior vis-a-vis conservatives, everyone who is not ultra-Orthodox, reform as well, should be changed. And the Israel should stop expecting American Jewry to repeat whatever comes from Jerusalem, but to have a mature discussions about where we go.
We learn in your book that when Benjamin Netanyahu was still a teenager, you were his commander in Sayeret Mahtal, Israel's special forces commando. You write that Netanyahu displayed a mix of strength, endurance, and luck during one treacherous mission at the Suez Canal. Did you see a future prime minister of Israel in that young man?
Not at the time, probably because I was already a lieutenant colonel, he was a young lieutenant. Probably more, first of all, he was a good officer, really good officer, practical, ambitious, and focused. His elder brother, the one who was killed in Entebbe, Yoni, was one of my closest friends. He was several years older, and he was my deputy in this, the command of this unit. And in a way, he seemed more kind of likely, more contemplative, with many areas of interest beyond what we have been doing on the ground at night or behind the enemy lines. He was interested in poetry, in philosophy, in literature, and was much more contemplative. But I don't want to underestimate Bibi. He's far from being a lightweight. He's a thoughtful, knowledgeable person with a lot of experience right now, a good politician, and he's the elected prime minister. It's not, he didn't parachute there from nowhere. But in the recent years, especially the last 3 years, he gradually drifted into a mindset which is extremely pessimist, passive, deeply anxious, and self-victimizing. That's a quite good recipe if you think about it for politics, because you never initiate anything, you can never be blamed for something that happened. And whenever something is happening, after all, you can always argue that it's the circumstances, it's, you are not a demigod. But it's very poor recipe for statesmanship, especially of the Zionist state. Because Zionism had been based from day one on a concrete and clear idea that we are going to take our fate in our hands, not just letting drift to wherever history takes us, and make decisions that will proactively define the direction we are heading to. And that's something which is totally absent now. In a way, those guys that you mentioned earlier, Bennett and Avigdor Lieberman, many Bennett and the extreme right-wingers, they are dictating the direction for Netanyahu. And that's very bad, because nowadays they are focused on an idea which might sound, especially in a synagogue, very tempting or almost seducing that we have a right from heaven to control the whole biblical lens. It was ours, the Almighty gave it to us. But I always tell my friends from the right wing, I have many friends there, I tell them, look at the maps of the previous attempts in Jewish sovereignty, the dynasty of King David and Solomon, and many hundred years later, the Maccabean. There were only two periods of Jewish sovereignty. And look at the map. All the promises were even then. A Brit Ben Abtarim and the divine promise were already there. And the map went like accordion. Why is this? Because to implement the right is always there, but to implement it, you need the right circumstances, geopolitical circumstances, and as the Talmud told us, don't accelerate the Messiah, he will come on his own time. Don't try here on the ground to tell him when to come. Don't climb in the wall, they call it. Don't challenge the big powers of the time. And please avoid too much internal hatred among ourselves. These are the three lessons that the Talmud got from both cases of Churban, of full destruction of our sovereignty. And it's I'm always frustrated to see that the people who represent the Jewish...
There's a medical situation. Oh. Someone has passed out.
I always was frustrated to see that the first ones in Israeli politics to forget the three lessons and recommendations of the Talmud are those who called themselves religious nationalist people and became some populist, ultra-nationalist guys who are good patriots. They really believe in what they argue for. They always, when you push them to the corner and tell them, but this will end with either non-Jewish or non-democratic situation, they ultimately look to heaven, waiting for some divine intervention. So they are great patriots with great beliefs, but totally detached from a reality check and from the consequences of where they are heading. And this should be corrected, and in a democracy it could be corrected only in the ballot and through a much more assertive and active attitude toward what happens on the ground in Israel.
You devote a fascinating chapter in your book to your experiences on the front lines of the war on terrorism, including your celebrated mission to Beirut, which was depicted in Steven Spielberg's film Munich. Significantly, and for reasons you will all understand, that chapter is titled Uzis and Eyeshadow. You write, and I'm quoting you, "What we were being asked to do in Beirut was not an act of revenge, but a preemptive attack and a deterrent." Does that help to explain why the kind of spectacular acts of terrorism that we saw in the 1970s are no longer carried out against Israel?
I'm not sure. I was, in a way, I went into all these operations extremely focused on how to complete it successfully. But after we rescued the hostages on the tarmac of Ben Gurion Airport, it was called Lod Airport at the time, with some over 100 passengers. It never happened again that a terrorist hijacked an airplane landed in Israel. But terror didn't stop. The same happened, you know, we had this operation in Beirut following the massacre of our athletes in Munich. It was celebrated as a brilliant operation, but it didn't stop the terror. It continued. In a way, we are facing the same terror right now. The only difference is that both sides are learning from our from experience. So the next time they hijacked an airplane full of Israelis, or half full with Israelis, hundreds of them, they took it to Entebbe. They did not believe that we can reach Entebbe. But once we reached Entebbe, they went to other operations. So basically, we are still facing terror. We should have no illusions. Terror will continue. It's a generational war. And even after ISIS was defeated on the ground in the Middle East, with modern communication, the social networks and whatever, they are capable of inspiring people all around the world, including on American soil, to carry out terrorist operations without ever meeting face to face an ISIL person. So we are in a generational fight, and we have to stand firm. It cannot be defeated without international cooperation, but that's part of a list of other issues that cannot be solved without international or global cooperation, an element or a conclusion that goes against what we see now, both in this country, in Israel, in many other corners of the world, that governments turn more and more into populist, egocentric, inward-looking, ultranational kind of approach to global issues.
You tell a remarkable story about a mission against a unit of Fatah in a Jordanian town called Karameh in 1968. You write, "By the time we arrived, the Fatah fighters, many in civilian clothes, were racing past us in the other direction. One of them, we later discovered, was Yasser Arafat. He escaped on a motorcycle."
32 disguised as a woman.
Disguised. 32 years
the
later.
Pattern of leaders in the Middle East.
32 years later, you sat across a table at Camp David from Yasser Arafat. And I have two questions to ask. One is, did that come up? Did that near miss come up?
Yeah, it came up even earlier, long before I was, several years before I became prime minister. I was foreign minister, as the rabbi was already mentioned, in Shimon Peres government. And my first mission was to go to Barcelona, to participate in some meeting of Mediterranean leaders, which included Arafat. And because of security reasons, we were sent ahead of the other leaders into this royal palace in Barcelona. And I found myself suddenly with Arafat. In fact, I came ahead of him and I found a small Steinway, very lovely one. So I played some piece and suddenly I saw Arafat coming. So I came to him, I told him, "You know, I'm glad to finally meet you. For many years I watched you through the site." And I remember my first impression was about how fragile, how physically fragile person he was. I was afraid that if I would really hug him like the Middle Eastern way, he will crush in my hand. But of course it was raised. He, when we were left alone for a small meeting, one-on-one with one or two aides on each side, he explicitly blamed me. He said, "Barak, we know from our intelligence reports that you are against any peace with us. You are part of a organization." He used the name OAS. OAS was a French group of officers who were kind of active against the Gaulle. These are the ones who tried to kill the Gaulle when he tried to make peace because they were not satisfied with his readiness to leave Algeria. So you are the head of the Israeli OAS and you are coercing the government into not making any such steps toward it. But, you know, later I remember even some 15 years earlier, the result of our kind of attempts to kill Arafat. I mentioned in the book, at a certain point I planned an operation, not Karame, another one, deliberately set to kill Mr. Arafat. And when I came to push it to my superiors, I was the commander of our equivalent of SEAL Team 6, or Delta Forces, long before those units came into existence. When I came to my superior generals, the one who was responsible for me looked at me and said, Arafat, he's fat, he's a politician, he's not a target. So I had to give up the operation. 10 years later, Sharon became Minister of Defense. The first thing he asked us when we gathered, I was at the time already a ranking general, said, how comes that you do not have plans to kill Arafat? And he made a point to remind us that when he was young officer in uniform, he never waited for anyone to ask him to plan such operations. He would initiate them and push it to the decision-maker echelons in order to either get the approval to do it or at least leave them with the responsibility that it didn't happen. So I laughed and told him, Arik, that's exactly what I've done 10 years ago. And the answer I got from one of your colleagues is that he's a fat politician and not a target. So it was raised. He knew it. In certain points, he tried to, when we blamed it in Camp David, that we told, you have to change. You are the leader of a terrorist group, basically. He raised with Clinton the question, but how about Barak? He doesn't have blood on his hands. Or Shahak, there was another deputy of myself at the time who was later on a minister, and he participated in Camp David. He said, Barak and Shahak also have blood on their heads. So I told Clinton, look, yes, it's true. I killed Palestinians from the distance from myself to the first row here. But it were always terrorists that a freely elected democratic government sent me to kill in order to deter them or prevent a coming operation. We never sent deliberately to kill innocent civilians or older people or kids. It's true that sometimes there were some collateral damage, someone was killed, but never, it was never the objective of the operation. But you, Mr. Arafat, once and again, and President Clinton, you have seen it, once and again sent your people with explosive charge deliberately to leave them in buses, in discotheques, in pizza shops, in restaurants, in discotheques, in order to murder innocent people and frighten or terrorize the minds and souls and self-confidence of the general public. I told him, that's the difference. We are in a fight, but we are fighting in different manners.
A thought occurs to me, what language did you speak to Arafat? What language did he speak to you?
Usually English. He made himself as if he doesn't perfectly understand, so it gave him some time to think more, but and sometimes in Arabic, but I could speak Arabic for a kind of daily, mundane kind of contact. I cannot follow a subtle line of thought in Arabic. I cannot express myself good enough, and I cannot understand the nuances. So I prefer to do it in English. And he basically knew English quite well, but he was not a person to negotiate with. He never kind of would answer a question or put a position that can be defined as a position about certain issue on the table. He would always tell stories. Kind of, I would call it parable, so I don't know the name in English. He told you a story, and you remain with the puzzle. You have to think later what he meant by this story. For example, when he wanted to project to us that he recognized the Jewish people as members of a religion, of a faith, but not as a nation with rights on the biblical land. He told the story, probably invented it, that he, first of all, he invented that he was born in Jerusalem, then he invented that his aunt had a piece of real estate in a quarter of Jerusalem, the old city, which called the Maghrebi quarter, which is the place that all of you know as the big square now facing the Wailing Wall, the Kotel. It was flattened by us immediately after we took over Jerusalem in 67, but this was called the Maghrebi quarter. So he told, my aunt has a house there, and as a kid I was visiting her, and I always saw these Jews, it was very narrow alley at the time, praying there and crying in front of this wall with black long coats, and we never disturbed them. But of course, he never agreed that we have a right there, because he has his family, so to speak, has property rights in this very place, which is now the big square in front of the Wailing Wall. So it wasn't easy to discuss with him, but basically, you know, it's, when it became clear that he is not moving, and the offer that Clinton and myself put on the table was extremely far-reaching, metaphorically covering 90%+ of everything you could think of, and we never tried to dictate it to him. It's not true that we told him, take it or leave it. No, we told him explicitly, you can have your reservation from any paragraph or from every paragraph in this offer. We just expect you to accept it as a basis for negotiation. He deliberately rejected it and turned to terror. So when it became clear that that's the case, I told Clinton, look, this guy who is rejecting any logic offer, he already holds a Nobel Peace Prize, but he probably more properly deserves an Oscar.
I feel very privileged to be able to ask you the next question. There's a narrative that has attached itself to the Camp David summit, and it touches on the subject you have just raised, that you went as far as any Israeli prime minister had ever gone or could ever go in accommodating Palestinian demands. And it wasn't enough. And so people who criticize the two-state solution often cite that as proof that there could never be a settlement that Israel could live with and the Palestinians would accept. Is that a true or an accurate way to look at what happened in that room between you and Yasser Arafat?
First of all, there is another legend from the other side of the political aisle that blames me for coining this statement. There is no partner that since then settled in the minds of souls of the whole region and blocks any advancement. And that's not true as well. That's not what I've said. I just said we do not have a partner in Arafat at the present time, which is objective description of the situation that I made in order to convince our people that under the basic premises of Zionism, the fact that the other side doesn't want to make peace, you know, that's a difference between war and peace. For war, one party suffice. You announce war and there is a war. For peace, it's like tango, it takes two. So the fact that he doesn't want or is not ripe or ready for it doesn't mean that it should paralyze us. The whole Zionist story about always holding the moral high ground, always proposing the right venue toward doing it in coordination. But if we don't have a partner, I thought we should take active steps. We should delineate on our own a line within the holy promised land, within which we will have all our security needs and all the settlement block with some 80% of the settlers, which cover altogether no more than 5 or 6% of the area of the West Bank. And this is something that we need in Israel, probably could be sold through some land swap. But beyond this area, there is area full of Palestinians where we can or have still to keep security responsibility for obvious reasons. But this is an area which at the right time should be the area of the viable Palestinian demilitarized state. And, you know, that's something that I couldn't convince my camp, the center-left people in Israel, that that's a reasonable consequence of what happened at Camp David. They all were kind of still waiting for something, following the vision that Peres was pushing for a long time, that if you just believe in it strongly enough, and a crack will open in heaven through which a small cherubic angel will come hugging a new Middle East, and peace will come on heaven. This kind of peace will happen only when, you know, when the lion and the lamb can lie together and you don't have to replace the lamb every 2 days or so. So that's a far-reaching vision. You have to wait. We have to be practical. My own camp behaved somewhat, I say childishly is a somewhat insulting term, but not as mature kind of collective. You know the difference between infancy and maturity. A baby, the paradigm by through which he perceives the world is, daddy, I want. Baby doesn't have any need to explain more. Baby says, daddy, I want. And if daddy doesn't come with what the baby wants, daddy disappointed baby and baby is angry. Mature people know that they can aspire for very high, probably against all odds, and they can try to reach things which seems to be impossible, but they have all along the way to take into account the reality principles, to take into account reality. You cannot operate without understanding reality. That was missing on our side. On the other side, it became a kind of proof that nothing can happen, and until these days, if you listen carefully to the voice come from the Jerusalem, basically they keep telling you something that was invented by Prime Minister Shamir, a man who I liked very much, even loved, but always didn't accept his position. He basically used to say, the sea is the same sea, the Arabs are the same Arabs, nothing can come out from there. So that, as a description of reality, is totally false. It's just not congruent with realities. In 67, 50 years ago, when he took over the whole brilliant triumph, all these territories, the government of Israel said that we take Jerusalem, the rest of it is a deposit for the time the other side is ready to make peace. The Arab League gathered 3 months later in Khartoum and announced the three famous no's. No for negotiation, no for recognition, no for peace. Whatever was taken by force will be brought back by force. But is this the reality right now? For 40 years now we have a peace with Egypt. Not as perfect as the peace between you and Canada, but a peace which stood the test of Israeli tank divisions rolling into neighboring Arab capital and didn't collapse. It stood the test of Egypt taken by the Muslim Brotherhood, and it didn't collapse. And now the cooperation is much deeper than the eye meets when Sisi fighting Al-Qaeda or ISIS or whatever in the Sinai. And 25 years we have a peace with Jordan, which has the longest border. And not just Rabin and myself, Bibi Netanyahu tried very hard to strike a deal with Assad, the father, not the present one. And Sharon and Menachem Begin tried very hard to make peace with Lebanon. So now, it's not just that we have a main pillars, Egypt and Jordan, already in peace with us. The Arab League, the same Arab League which announced the three no's in Khartoum in 67, for 15 years, we have on the table an Arab League proposal, backed by a Saudi proposal that basically proposed to recognize Israel, to normalize relations, to accept Israel into the region as an equal member, based on a solution that will stick to the borders of 67. Of course, we cannot accept the borders of 67, we have other reservations. But to say that it's the same landscape, or to argue seriously that we cannot start negotiation on the basis of this Saudi Arab League proposal, it's just violation of the reality principle. And it, once again, it's a proof that post-truth, alternative facts, fake news, were invented originally in Israel, long before these terms got any traction in the English language. We are the made it a form of art, especially our present government.
I have to ask a very painful question.
Please.
The tactic of sending thousands of men, women, and children to the border between Israel and Gaza resulted in horrific images of violence, which is precisely what Hamas was hoping to achieve. But surely it creates more problems for Israel when dozens of Arabs are killed, thousands are injured, all while the world is watching, and not a single casualty is reported on the Israeli side. As a combat veteran, as a former chief of staff of the IDF, as a man who understands the security of Israel, was there a different and better way to deal with the crowds that came to the border?
I prefer to make a difference between the technical issue that faced our forces a few days ago, how to tackle the massive riots or demonstrations, and the more general issue of what could be done to avoid it. On the technical level, it's very complicated. We have extremely sophisticated means and tools to suppress and control riots when the riots are about the size of this audience here, several hundred people from distances of 10 to 30 yards. There are no effective means as of now to suppress riots where the audience is many thousands and the distance is 300 yards. And probably it's a pity that we did not develop it, but we do not have, and no one else have effective means to do it. So on a practical level, we have to make sure that they do not cross the border, especially those of us who believe in the need to disengage from the Palestinians, to want a divorce from Palestinians, and end up with a two-state solution with a border. We have to start with respecting borders. But it is not just the importance of border on principle. It's a practical issue that sometimes several dozens of yards beyond the fragile fence, there are a moshav or a kibbutz or infrastructure, industrial infrastructure or agricultural infrastructure, which is highly vulnerable. So we just could not afford them going through it. And however painful, and it's really painful to see it, no one is happy to see 60 people being buried, some of them very young people. Some of them tried to put explosives or some other kind of attempts of violent kind of behavior, but most of them probably were just part of these masses. not 60, even six or two. Two people dead, innocent civilians are two graves too many. But to judge it from the rules of engagement, we could not have at the present better rules. Probably in 6 months or in a year from now, certain elements might be developed to answer these technical challenges. But looking at the wider picture, we have a lot to think of. How come the point that we are still there with so much energy and steam and violent energies coming out of Gaza? We have to remember, we have nothing against the Gazans. There are almost 2 million people. They are normal people, they are Palestinians, they are Arabs, but they are basically want to see their children grow, they're healthy and whatever, and the situation is quite tough there. Very few hours of electricity, very poor quality of water, very little equipment, or not equipment, but the materials which are needed in the hospitals to treat people effectively, and it's tough situation there. And that had to be smoothed or reduced dramatically long ago. In a way, it's not something new that we learned in the recent operation. For a year, probably 2 years now, our defense establishment, the leaders of the IDF, the heads of the Shabak, the Secret Service, the office of the coordinator of government activities in the territories, they are all presenting the government with series of proposals, what could be done in order to reduce the coming humanitarian crisis in Gaza. And for reasons that I cannot penetrate, the government is not responding to these recommendations from its own professional layers of people who are dealing with security. They fully understand what they are doing and they are recommending. Even within the government, there are several ministers, including a quite prominent minister of transportation, who for 2 years now keep raising the idea, why don't we allow the Gulf states and some others, but with our permission, to build an artificial island in front of Gaza, which will become a place for an airport, for a seaport, fully controlled by international agencies with Israeli cameras or microphones, whatever you need to make sure that it does not become a source of smuggling of weapons or whatever, and do it to change the situation. That's a grave mistake, which is stretched over several years. And the same applies to the real challenges we have now. For several years now, we are talking a lot about the common interest with the moderate Sunnite leaders in the region, Gulf states, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, Jordan, in struggling radical Muslim terror, in joining hands in cornering or putting at bay the Iranian hegemonic and nuclear intention, and even go together for huge infrastructure projects in the region. And we are talking about it, but never doing what has to be done in order to let it happen. And bear in mind, vis-a-vis the Palestinians, we tend to argue that why should we do an agreement with them? We can only give them something. We cannot get anything from them, which is not accurate, but it's a conventional wisdom. But with the Arab world, it's clear we have a lot to get. To be accepted into the region as members of the community, that's a huge change in our situation. And we are not there. Reason is that the whole regional agreement cannot fly if Israel doesn't take sincere steps to go forward with the Palestinian authority in the West Bank and with the Gaza. And reason is that not that the Arab leaders have a love affair with the Palestinian leadership, they do not have, but because their publics have, and the Arab moderate leaders do not feel safe in their own seats if they engage publicly in Israel and accept us into the region, and the Palestinians are still, as they describe it, under our boots. And that's something that has to be thought over by us, especially when it's clear that it has nothing to do with security. This is also a fake news and totally wrong description. Those who tell you that the isolated settlements and the continuation of putting a settlement in between every two significant villages or towns in the whole Judea and Samaria is important for our security. It is not. It's a burden on our security. The government tells the people something which is not true. And when you ask all the leaders of the IDF, the Secret Service, Mossad, the police, whoever, they will, 90% of them will tell you, Israel will be more secure when we divorce from the Palestinians, disengage from them, put a border, and leaving a viable place for a Palestinian state to emerge at the right time when the Palestinians are ready for it.
Thank you. Do you regard the opening of an embassy for the United States in Jerusalem as a good thing or a bad thing for Israel?
I think it's by definition a good thing. I think it should have happened 70 years ago, for sure 25 years ago, after the Congress and a bipartisan resolution demanded from the president to pass it. And we are thankful for Trump for making it happen. The Arab, it raised some anger among Palestinians and other Arabs, but partially not for a reason, because the moving of the embassy, the American embassy to Jerusalem, does not exclude the possibility, may I say, the certainty, that when the time comes and the Palestinians are coming to grip with realities and strike a deal with us, they will have their own capital, probably including several heavily habitated Arab neighborhoods in Jerusalem, in eastern Jerusalem, and they will announce it, El Quds, their capital, and for sure the American embassy will be situated there. So it does not exclude anything important.
I'm going to ask one or two more questions, and then we'll invite the audience to participate. And Ted and perhaps someone else will be in the audience with the microphone. Do you think Israel is more or less at risk because our president has withdrawn from the Iran treaty?
You know, I thought it's a bad deal. You know, when this deal was announced by President Obama, and I was asked how I feel about it, I said, mixed feelings. You know what is mixed feeling? It is when your mother-in-law drives your new BMW over the cliff. And they are all laughing before, because they even they have a mother-in-law of that kind or a new BMW. So it was a bad deal. But once President Obama decided on it, it became part of reality. And in politics, you don't have to spend too much energy on crying or complaining or lamenting on milk that has already been spilled. The same applied to this new decision. You know, I thought that it's not necessary, because the elements which are under scrutiny now, all of them are not part of this agreement. The Iranian, whether we like it or not, are basically complying with the agreement. Development of missiles, which is clearly relevant to nuclear program, is not part of the agreement. Sowing insurgencies and terror all around the region is not part of the agreement. So more logical approach would have been to call upon the Europeans, probably Russia, and try to coordinate with them a policy where they will, together, you approach the Iranians and tell them, gentlemen, that cannot continue. we want to open negotiation about further subjects which are out of the agreement. And if you reject it, we will consider how to respond. So basically, it was unneeded. But once again, once it has been done, it's part of reality. It doesn't cancel the agreement because the others are still there and will stay there, as I see. But once it had been done, it has good news and bad news about it. Good news is that it made the Iranians much more cautious. They see a totally unpredictable president, with Pompeo on one side of him and Bolton on the other side. They genuinely suspicious that the next step might be that the American administration is waiting for the slightest mistake, violation, or even fabricated violation of the agreement, which will lead to American surgical attack on their nuclear facilities. And this worry makes them more cautious and probably will even push them to announce this more kind of openness for more inspection. So in a way, that's what happened to Kim Jong-un. He never thought of dismantling his nuclear arsenal. He realized that he's facing totally unpredictable administration here. So he decided to get warmer relationship with the South, and he announced that he will dismantle his test site. Why to dismantle the test site? Because he doesn't need it anymore. He already knows how to build atom bombs and how to build a hydrogen bomb. He probably have half a dozen of the first and one or two of the second. And he knows that with time passing, he can produce more. In order to avoid some inconceivable but practically possible attack, he decides that to warm the relation with the South might solve it. He might wait until midterm, probably until 2020, or probably another 4 years. His father did it. His grandfather did it. They never intended to cancel the program. But if this summit next, the 12th of June, I believe, will happen somehow, one of the arguments that the North Korean negotiator will raise will be, how comes we have to sign an agreement with you? What sense it makes to sign an agreement with the American president if the next president can wake up one morning and just cancel it? Yes. And the same somehow applies to the Iranians. When and if they will decide to break out from the agreement and to resume their enrichment of uranium, they will argue that they are not the first to break this agreement. It was already been broken by the administration. So there is good and bad consequences to it, but it's part of reality. So I don't think that Israel is stronger or weaker. I thought, when I asked what we should have done, I think we should have done it already with Obama, but we should do it now with Trump. We have to sit behind closed doors, not for the public knowledge, behind closed doors, and first of all, make sure that enough intelligence resources are invested in knowing what the Iranians are doing, but because that will be critical, just to know what they're doing. Secondly, to define what makes a breakout, what defines a violation of the agreement and running back toward nuclear program. It has technical aspects that should be agreed upon. And then what should bring back the surgical military operation to the table, whether is it an American one or an Israeli one. These issues should be clarified, defined, and put later on the shelf. It will help deal with the crisis when the real challenge comes to our face.
Thank you, Mr. Prime Minister. We'll go to the audience now for questions. Please raise your hand, and Ted will come to you.
Yeah, just a quick reminder at Live Talks Los Angeles, questions typically start with a W or an H, sometimes a D. They are generally short, and tonight only Jonathan Kirsch gets to ask follow-up questions.
And they end with a question mark.
Mr. Prime Minister, thank you. I had a question. When we left Gaza, the moment we left, rockets started flying out of Gaza. If the Israeli military was in Gaza right now, most likely it wouldn't be happening what's happening right now. What could guarantee that the West Bank wouldn't turn into Gaza?
You probably don't remember accurately. Can anyone tell me how many rockets were launched from Gaza in the year before we left, when we still were there? No one knows here. The number is 1,500.
Wow.
Not less than we experienced in the last several years. How many Israelis, settlers, and soldiers were killed in Gaza Strip in the year before we left? No one knows the answer. 34. So when you compare the actual numbers, not the propaganda, you find a different reality. It is not an incident or coincidence that no serious Israeli, including in the right wing, in the most assertive and aggressive figures there, no one genuinely or seriously recommend to go back to Gaza and resume the situation previous to our pullout, even if you propose to them that somehow miraculously it will happen without losing the life of a single soldier. Because deep in their hearts, they remember that we now turn from distance to look at it as a somewhat pastoral landscape. It had never been so. So the same apply to other cases. I keep telling the public, the people who rhetorically blame everyone else for risking our security, because if there is a Palestinian state, probably the Palestinians will become Gaza. And I ask him, but who is bringing the missiles and the Hamas to the West Bank? These are the cabinet ministers who are trying to destroy the Palestinian Authority. I repeatedly ask them, who do you believe will replace the Palestinian Authority once you succeed to destroy them? Would it be the youth of Beitar? No. Would it be the Bnei Akiva? No. It will be the Hamas. But by then you will complain. We warned you in advance that they will come. Yes, you warned us in advance, but you made it happen. So I always refer to logic. We have to be able to keep a sober and realistic grip on events, on facts, when we decide what to do. The real enemy of 80% of the settlers beyond the Green Line, the settlers, 80% of them, in the settlement blocks and in the Jewish suburbs in Jerusalem, is the government which try to avoid or blurring the difference between those 80% in the settlement blocks and in the suburbs of Jerusalem, and the 20% which are spread all over the area, as I mentioned earlier, poking into the eyes of Palestinians, and make it, to those of you who know our tradition, tafasta merube lo tafasta. You try to reach everything, you will end up with nothing, and don't blame others for your own fault. The right approach would be to make a difference. And everyone who wants to know the details or follow the details, I strongly recommend to you, enter on the web to a site called Commanders for Security of Israel, something like cs.org.il. This is the elite of our commanders, hundreds of generals of the IDF, of the Secret Service, of the police, of Mossad, who all will tell you, will find there the recommendation. The same recommendation for practical steps, answering your question, both in the West Bank and in Gaza Strip. that should have been done. They were proposed once and again to the government, not just by this organization of civilians, but also by people who are still in uniform or in service, and our government is failing to do it because of ideological mindset or block in their mindset, which leads them to believe that they have a mission. I call it a mission with a messianic tinge, to close the door on any opportunity of divorce in order to fulfill the biblical promises, to accelerate the Messiah and make our control of the whole biblical land irreversible. It's against the crucial interests of Israel, and it's, this is the main issue of debate in our dispute back home right now.
Mr. Prime Minister, what events would have to happen for you to run again for Prime Minister, and with which Arab or which Palestinian would you like to negotiate?
I prefer not to come back, and I fully support it, even encouraged by my wife, not to go back into it. In politics, you can never say never, but I think that in order for a situation being created that I feel compelled to go back, it should be so bad that I hope it will never happen. So I try to wake up the public through my activities, by talking to them. I fly a lot around the world right now, so I almost permanently under jet lag, so I wake up 2:00 a.m. in the morning. What is better to do than to follow the great example of President Trump and start to tweet? So I tweet at night, very harsh critic of Bibi, whom I personally have more empathy than many of his inner circle of ministers, but I do it deliberately very harsh because otherwise no one listens, and try to wake up the people to see what is wrong and what should be done. I hope I won't be in a need to join myself. We need one of the ladies.
Yeah, here comes.
Hi. You obviously, we're all watching with great concern what's going on in Gaza this week, and you talked earlier about some of the things that could have been. The international community obviously blames Israel in large part for the humanitarian crisis. In what ways do you think Israel is responsible for the humanitarian crisis in Gaza, and what could they do to help alleviate some of those problems?
I think I already answered it earlier. I said that we have to take the recommendation that you might find in this site that I mentioned, and I mentioned that our authorities proposed it, to let more of them working here, to make sure that they have more supply of electricity, to make sure that better water treatment is possible there, to make sure that enough equipment, or not equipment, but materials for the hospitals will enter, and to allow them to go in and out, and to coordinate with the Egyptians, that the Egyptians as well will open at least partially their gates to the Gaza Strip. There are a lot of things that could be done, even to build this island. There are many things that could be done. We have to do it. It's not from today to the next week, but you have to start somewhere. And just to give a proportion, you know, during the real operation that we had there, every several years we had a major operation, it's not 60 people, sometimes 1,000 people or 1,500 people were killed as a result of the activity against terrorists who are deliberately operated from within schoolyards or near health installation or near United Nations installations in the Gaza Strip. So there is a problem there that should be treated more profoundly by not just by us, but by the Arab and world community. But Israel should be ready for it and open the doors for any such activity.
Mr. Prime Minister, I would like to thank you for teaching me how to negotiate. When you made your proposal, and it was so inclusive, all-inclusive, I really said to myself, I think that's too much. There was only one thing that you left out. You left out of taking everybody by the hand and going to the Mediterranean. That would have solved their problem.
I'm not sure that I got the point in your question.
My question is, how do you negotiate with somebody who does not want to negotiate?
You know, you cannot know until you try. That's a matter of fact. And when I came to power, it was 6 years after Israeli governments committed themselves to the Oslo process. We were 3 years after the nominal time to start permanent status negotiation. Netanyahu, not Rabin or Peres, Netanyahu is the man who gave back Hebron, the city of the cave of the patriarchs to the Palestinians. Netanyahu, not Peres, Rabin or myself, is the person who gave the Palestinians, after negotiation, 13% of the area. We were ready to go very far, but I never gave them anything. We were ready to stop and even dismantle isolated settlements, but under my government, the extreme right wing are still praising me for building in the settlement blocks, which are supposed to remain part of Israel, 4 times more units than Bibi ever did. So it's all you compare real leadership in the real world. You do not compare your wishful thinking. And when I came there, I saw already very clear that we are heading toward an explosion. I don't say it in retrospect. When I was still head of opposition before I defeated Bibi in election, I warned Bibi's government, you are all sitting on the deck of the Titanic. No way you don't see the iceberg. And I approached them one by one. I said, Arik Sharon, no way you don't see the iceberg. Raful, another general, no way you don't see the iceberg. Itzik Mordechai, a third general, no way you don't see the iceberg. And even you, Bibi was just a captain, you also see the iceberg. So we are heading into a shoot eruption of violence, much more violent than the first intifada. The only way to make clear that we fight it united with support of the world when it comes was to make a last minute effort to avoid it through negotiation. There is no other way not to know for yourself and not to prove to your own people or the world that there is no way. When I came there, I described it to Clinton. I told him, look, we are like two families living in the same house made of two cottages. And fire is starting to erupt there. And both households, owners are coming, trying to put it off. One of them already carries the world awards of firefighters in the form of the Nobel Peace Prize. But you don't know that he's not the arsonist which carries the gasoline and the match in his pocket. And there is no way to know but by trying. So I'm confident that I did the right thing to do it, to negotiate. We'll see. If there is the slightest chance, we'll keep negotiating and we'll avoid the tragedy of full-scale eruption. If we can't do it, at least we will know, our people who from whom we demand the sacrifice, and the whole world will know that we were there, we were ready, we are not just stronger, as we will prove in the clash itself. We already keep hold of the moral high ground. That's very important for Israel. I never regretted doing it all along my public life.
We have time for two more questions.
Hi, thank you. Just from the standpoint of the most decorated soldier, what was your, or what do you think now was your psychology as a soldier, and how did that impact your political career and who you are as a person now? And did you relish it in the same way like Churchill did, that experience of being a soldier?
Oh, being a soldier is part of the life experience of most Israelis. I ended up in a special forces unit in its embryonic phase as a result of accidents. It's accidental, you might find it in the book. But once I was there, I tried to do my best. And basically, we created, as I mentioned earlier about Sharon, we used to initiate operations and to raise ideas for operations no one thought are possible. And we never accepted the conventional thinking about limits. We knew that we cannot act against physics, but everything else, which is psychology or tradition or conventional wisdoms, we ignored. And along probably 15 years, it became extremely important phenomena in Israel. I found myself in many kind of operations. Most of them are not yet disclosed to the public. But that's part of, you know, it's this unit was a great phenomenon in Israel. It's not a coincidence that you find among the veterans, commanders of this unit, not just myself and Bibi, Prime Minister, you find many other prominent people in Israel, in many arenas of life. It was always not just about biceps or muscles, it was about a brain and thinking faster and better than the enemy. And it somehow attracted many capable youngsters who later on are all around the country in many leading kind of roles.
And our final question for the evening?
A three-part question. Do you think it's necessary, in order to have peace with the Palestinians, that they accept Israel's right to exist? Do you think they accept Israel's right to exist today? And if they do not, what do you think it'll take for Palestinians to accept Israel's right to exist?
I think that it is important that they accept our right to exist. I think that if you look carefully into the Arab League proposal or into the Saudi plan, you will find that they are basically ready to recognize the right of Israel to exist. I want to put a certain kind of, let you think a little bit about the meaning of it. All along our life as a Zionist movement, we never expected anyone else to prove us. We said that we are going against all odds to stop this tragedy in Eastern Europe and in North Africa of Jews under heavy deprivation, and we are going to establish our sovereignty in the Holy Land, the place where we were born as a faith, as a nation, and as a civilization. We never asked permission from anyone. We never asked recognition from anyone. When we made a peace with Egypt, the strongest and most important Arab country, we never demanded that they will recognize our right to existence. We expected they will accept Israel and recognize Israel. As a matter of fact, we didn't ask them to turn into Zionists. When we made the agreement with King Hussein of Jordan, we never demanded that he will recognize our right to exist as a Jewish state. Of course, we expected him to accept the right of Israel to exist as a neighboring state with all sovereign rights. But we never asked anyone else to approve our nature as a Jewish state. When Bibi asked, negotiated with Assad, sending Ronald Lauder on a shuttle, he raised many issues, security, demilitarization, intelligence, embassies, normalization, everything. He never raised the need that Assad will approve the nature of Israel as a Jewish state. And even in Oslo, neither when Peres and Rabin talked to them, and not when Bibi talked to them, in White Plantation, when he gave them Hebron, the place where the cave of the patriarchs is situated, he didn't ask that Arafat will recognize Israel as a Jewish state. Of course, we expect that he will recognize Israel as a sovereign state which is here. So, when you ask our sentiment, we also want everyone to applaud to us and everyone to accept the Zionist ideas, everything that we think we will be happy to be adopted. But if you will ask legal experts on international law, they might tell you that this demand that pointed now only at the Palestinians, not just to recognize Israel as a sovereign state and as a neighbor, but to recognize its destiny as a Jewish state, does not strengthen us, but weakens us. Reason is that the fact that we did not demand it from any other partner for peace makes it clear that we are ourselves, by our own demand, we realize and recognize the fact that the Palestinians have a different role within the conflict. Now, we know why we need them to recognize our Jewish nature, in order to avoid that the second step will be that once they have a state, they will start to incite the Arabs within Israel to demand not just personal rights of a minority, not just communal or cultural rights of minority, but national rights of minority. And we want to avoid it. But when you look it from close distance, you realize that from legal point of view, you are weakening your position by raising this issue with the Palestinians and not strengthening it. So that's just an extra food for thought. You have to think of issues with a cold head. Our sentiments, our gut feeling, our emotions, I don't feel less kind of resonating with Jewish history, everything that you see or feel in this wonderful synagogue, shouldn't it, than any other Jew. But I never lose sight of the need to act on the arena, on the real political arena, with first thinking, then acting, not the other way around. Don't let your emotion lead your policy. Let your brain lead it. It's always better.
Ladies and gentlemen, will you join me in thanking Prime Minister Ehud Barak?
Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you.